today we are doing something a little... Actually, I always start every video with we're doing something a little different. So, welcome back to Lead Follow, and this is the first of our podcast series. The series doesn't have a name yet. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But luckily, my friend Ross...
Hello, I'm Ross.
...is joining us today. Ed was going to try to make it, but unfortunately, lots of work commitments, and he has a broken Audi, and he has a broken RX-8, and he's very, very busy. So maybe we'll see him in the future on one of these. But Ross is...
He's always got something that's broken.
He's always got something broken, but usually he's back.
Also, is it a series of podcasts if this is the first?
Well, we don't know yet. We'll let the people at home decide whether they like these or not. Yes, so it's Sunday, and it's sunny, and you join me here at Ross's house, and we have all of our fancy new podcast equipment. Hopefully it wasn't a pointless investment. So, the first thing we want to be talking about today is probably the name for this podcast show, because I've been talking to a lot of people, and we've had some suggestions, some a bit more...
Do we have a name?
We have a series of names, and I wanted to see what you thought about them. So, the first one on the list is Exhausted Conversation.
Yes. Okay.
The next one is Couldn't Car Less.
That's pretty good.
Pretty good, yeah. That one, isn't it? And the third one, which actually came from Ryan, was Chatalytic Converser.
I mean, that's quite good.
It is pretty
good,
isn't
it? It's quite hard to say, though.
It is. That's something after you've had one too many Coronas.
Chatalytic Conversion?
Converser. Yeah. I'm not quite sure about that. I think Couldn't Car Less is actually the...
I think Couldn't Car Less is quite strong.
It's pretty good, isn't it? Yeah. Anyway, so there is no set schedule or script for this podcast. We're just going to basically chat the breeze about everything we've seen the last few months, everything in the news, what's going on with us, and what we're looking forward to in the future. So probably to start off with, shall we discuss your Giulia? Because you've had it for quite a while now.
And, nearly 7 years.
Yes. So ownership-wise, if you had to sum that up in a few words, what would you say for anybody out there that's looking to buy a used Giulia or even a new one and is thinking about the long-term lifestyle of them? And
My Giulia, it was like one of the first ones in the country.
Yeah.
Literally, as soon as they were on sale, I was doing man mass and was like, I can just about pay this. Just about. And my opinion was, I can just about do it now. There may not be another point in my life where I can just about do it. So I just kind of went for it. Mm. But yeah, my one's like really early 2017. So early that they kept ringing me up and asking me if I wanted this.
Oh yes.
I wanted the other plate. And I was like, no, I've bought my car, thanks. But in terms of ownership, it's been pretty painless, really. The only pain I had was like interacting with the Alfa Romeo dealer network, which is as bad as everybody makes out.
Yeah.
I will defend the cars until my dying breath, but the actual dealer network is crap.
Well, the more I see the Giulias on the road, the more I'm actually really liking the shape of them. It's a fantastic design.
They look so nice. Like, you know, it's not amazingly revolutionary. It's still like a saloon, but they just look really good, I think, especially if you get them in a metallic paint.
And it's a good size as well. I remember when I drove yours to the Bista Heritage Pistahead's 25th anniversary meet, and it's the first time I'd driven it, and I was quite surprised for a car of that size. It feels very small.
The cliche that motoring journalists come out with, shrinks around you, right?
Very much so, yeah. It felt like a two-door coupe. You don't realise how long it is behind you. You just obviously see from the B-pillars forward.
Yeah.
And it kind of felt very similar to my 86 in a way. It felt very...
Well, you sit quite low in the car. I think that makes a big difference. But it's weird because it's like... It's basically the same size as a 5 Series from like the early 2000s. It's amazing how big every single car has got like over time. But in terms of like how it's been and like during ownership, it's been... totally fine. It had a couple of faults, like in year 2 of ownership.
Silly things, though, if I remember correctly, wasn't it?
Well, it was. It kept going into. It did limp home mode a couple of times, and I took it into Alpha in Reading, and they replaced many hundreds of pounds worth of parts under warranty, and then it did it again, like 2 months later.
Oh yes, yeah.
And at that point, I was like, I don't really want to like have to tool around in another courtesy car for 3 weeks whilst they replace like a load of stuff that doesn't seem to do anything. So I just went on a forum, which I'd been on an Alpha forum for many years, and there was a few people with the same problem, and they were like, just take a look at this like connector that's like right at the front of the engine, underneath an intake pipe. It's got like a little one of those little yellow clips to sort of hold it in place.
Mm.
And they were saying my one had kind of broken a little bit, and there was like 2 mil of play in this connector. So I went and looked at mine, and lo and behold, it was the same thing. Basically, it's a bit of a silly design. There's like a rubber, big rubber intake pipe that's like that big. And it kind of sits on top of this connector, and it kind of slowly pushes on it.
Yeah.
And it just disconnects it a little teeny weeny little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
And the car, obviously the car engine management at that point, freaks out like crazy and sticks it in limp home mode. And the fix was simply to whack a
cable tie.
5p cable tie just to hold the thing in place. And... what, 5 years later, it's never had a repeat of that issue. In fact, it's never had any issues. The biggest issue I've had since then was I had a split coolant hose that made it look like steam was coming out of the engine, but it was like a little tiny split. But it was dripping onto the exhaust.
Yeah.
So when you pulled up at a set of traffic lights, you had all this steam coming out of the vents in the thing. But that was like... a very relatively simple fix.
Yeah.
So that's the only two problems I've had in the car in nearly 7 years. Mm. And it's done nearly 70,000 miles. It's been around many tracks. It's been to Spa.
Yeah, totally. Of course,
I love it. It's great. It's just it's one of those cars that is really good. You can just stick it in comfy mode and just drive back to and from work, which is what I used it for many years before the Rona. And it was super comfy. And then you could go to a track and stick it in track mode and it would try and kill you quite happily. so it's been a really good car. I'm really glad I bought it. And I'm really glad it's not been... because you would imagine if you buy... of any manufacturer, you buy the very first run of production.
Oh, yeah. You're the beta testers.
That's when you get all the issues, right? Mm. So the fact that I've had basically two issues with the car and all the time I've had it.
Because yours is a 66 plate,
yeah,
isn't it? Which means it's the first year of production.
Literally as new as you can get in this country.
Because they came out just before what you were mentioning earlier. They came out just before the change, 31st of March, whatever it was, when we went to the 17 reg back in 2017. So this would have been very early.
Well, the other thing was, if I'd have waited and got the new reg, it would have been the road tax would have gone from like £300 to like £500.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
So I was like, I'd rather save £200 and not. I don't really give a shit about the new reg.
Well, yeah, and I mean, when you buy a car with that kind of level of performance, me and Ed are talking about it all the time. We are quoted for saying supercar performance, supercar running costs, and the R35 GTR is a very good example of that, where they're quite well. When they first came out, they were like sub £100,000, and they were quite reasonable bang for buck for the price.
They weren't like £70,000 or something.
I think they were when they came out. But of course, what they don't tell you is that for that level of performance, you have to spend, you know, many thousands of pounds every year in the upkeep and brand new discs and
servicing.
Stuff.
Servicing is not a cheap thing.
But your car, if I understand correctly, the servicing has never been too expensive. I mean, the main consumable price for you is brakes and tyres.
Yeah, if you exclude brakes and tyres, and the brakes are quite expensive, and the tyres are quite expensive, it's probably been, I don't know, it's hard to say, because I always over-service my cars. It's something I've done for whenever, as long as I've had Alphas. It's like, there's there's no point in saving a few quid on a service, because it'll cost you at some point if something goes wrong. So, an average service for the car is like £500. A big service is get quite expensive. It's like £2,000, basically. But considering, like you say, a car 500 horsepower.
Exactly.
It's, you know, if you... this is the other thing I found when I bought it. Is like, looking... because when I bought it, it was quite... they've gone up in quite a lot in like new car costs. When I bought it, it was basically £60,000. And I looked around the market, and there was no other car that was brand new that had 500 horsepower that cost £60,000.
Yeah, exactly.
So, value for money, I guess you could call it value for money. But
Well, take away the brakes and the tyre costs aside, that car probably doesn't cost you any more to run than what a 2 litre Giulia petrol would.
Probably not.
Yeah.
It's certainly very comparable to a M3 or a C63. Like, I can't imagine they're cheap.
But it's a lot more interesting. I mean, the problem is when you buy yourself like an M4, M3 or a C63 or an Audi S4 or something like that, they're very much accountant's cars. No offence to anybody that's an accountant that has one, but it doesn't take a lot of imagination to just succumb to the German side of the performance saloon. It takes a little bit of guts to decide, no, I'm not going to have a German performance saloon. I'm going to get something a bit more flamboyant, a bit more Italian.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think C63s are great.
Yeah.
I probably would have bought one of those if the Junior hadn't come along and I was fancying a super saloon, I probably would have got...
Yeah.
V8 Mercedes.
Yeah.
But I think also it was helped by the fact that when it came out, the M3 at the time, which was the F80 or something, was not turning people on particularly much in the press, and they were like, it's not as good as the last one, etc., etc.
Well, they had a V8 in the last one, so...
Yeah, so, yeah. And then they had a turbocharged six-cylinder, which was a bit spiky, apparently, but...
Yeah.
So I think it was helped by the fact that it was good, and it was like genuinely a rival to the M3. And I think I've loved Alphas for a long time. I didn't ever want this thing that everybody else had.
Yeah.
And it's a good way to do that. It's like they're still like a fairly, modern company. They're part of FCA.
Yeah.
It's not like they're built by a man in a shed somewhere in Italy.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It's a mass produced.
So people sort of have this conversation. A lot of people look at you like you kind of bet your house on something. It's like, it's not really. It's just a car that might be slightly more hard work than a comparable German car. But I've had plenty of people tell me horror stories about German cars. So it all seems relative to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, on the subject of Italian cars and rear-wheel drive and V8, I think we've discussed this before in the past. The Quattroportes are getting very, very...
they're lovely.
It's hard to resist them. Well, I don't know the models, the curvy one, the latest. The
one that's like 2005.
Something like that, yeah. So they are the ones that have got the notorious... Duo Select or something.
Like an F1 gearbox or something.
Yeah, basically the Ferrari 355 gearbox.
It's all the same parts bin. So,
yeah, exactly. Now, they're getting very cheap now, and we've talked about it in the past in manual conversions. I mean, that is definitely on my list of project cars in the future. I think that would be fantastic.
Remind me where you'd get the manual gearbox from, because they were never offered with a manual, right, I think?
No, but some people just throw the existing box in the bin, and I've seen... people convert Quattroportes using Tremec T56s and all sorts of, like, Corvette Mustang gearbox and...
the other option is just buy a later version, because they switched from having a shonky automated manual to having a ZF6?
2008.
Eight?
Yeah, ZF6.
Which is just instantly a pretty great gearbox, even though it's an auto. But the manual sounds interesting. How would you root the tape? Because obviously there's nothing there to like root the linkage.
Well, there's no linkage.
I presume you start drilling holes in the firewall or something.
No, because on a front-wheel drive car like your GTA, of course, the gearboxes are out there and you need cables to link it to the shifter. But when it's a rear-wheel drive quattroporte, the gearbox is actually in the tunnel. So you've got to basically...
It just pokes up through
the
tunnel.
You've got to cut a hole through the transmission tunnel and mount the shifter mechanism. But you're probably right. I mean, right now on Auto Trader, because I did check the other night, the cheapest Quattroporte is, I think, $6,995, and that's one of those automated manual ones. And there's one for $8,995, which is a ZF6 beam. I think anybody in their right mind would pay the extra $2,000, they would get the auto.
You would think so.
Although, saying that, the place that I used to take my dad's Fiats to, because he had an automated manual, that is just the other side of Henley on Thames. And chatting to the guy who runs that place, he was saying there's so many new superseded parts for those older automated manuals now. They basically worked out all the bugs. So I was wondering whether it'd be worth, getting one of the cheaper ones.
Just buying all the superseded parts.
But then it's probably going to be a $2,000 bill to have it rebuilt the superseded parts, so you may as well just bought the ZF1.
Or converted it to manual. Yeah. I can't imagine the manual conversion is going to cost you more than a couple of grand. If you're doing the work yourself.
I think that would be the way. If you're going to in for a penny, in for a pound, I'd probably have to get myself an early automated manual Quattroporte and just decide I'm going to manual swap this and then just take it from there. See what happens.
I think the biggest issue you'd have is the ECU is set up to receive things from the gearbox, like when you're changing gear and stuff.
Although, I mean, you've got...
But it'd be a beautiful car if you made that manual. It'd be amazing.
You've got multi ECU scan.
Yeah.
Product that we've both used before. And I know you can turn flags on and off, so you could probably just go into that, find all the sensors for the automated system and just turn them off so it just stops warning about them. So that's something. But anyway, we digress. Mm. It's a product. It's a project.
One of the many projects you
may
have.
Never yeah. happen. It hasn't been going so far well with the projects on Lead Follow, because the first project I took on was the MR2 Roadster 2ZZ swap, and I decided not to 2ZZ swap it in the end because I couldn't do it for the car. I felt bad
kind
for
of
it.
You refurbished it pretty much, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I refurbed it. So yeah. I did a lot of what I set out to do in that, but I was happy to pass it on. And then, of course, I gave it to Michael. We got his V10 Audi, which is now Ed's property.
Yeah.
And I've moved on to the Flat 6 BRZ project, which actually... I'm starting to think maybe I won't do a BRZ. I'm starting to look at... there was a limited edition 86 that they only released in Japan called the GRMN.
Yes.
And it was white with carbon bonnet, carbon roof, carbon tailgate, and a red interior. You would basically, if you had to sum up that car, it would be a GT86 Type R.
It sounds very Honda-ish.
Yeah, it would be like, imagine if you gave a GT86 to Honda and said, please make this a Type R. That is basically what it was. And the more I look at it, I think to myself, ooh, that could be...
Was that all that was special about it? Or was there
no, it was a highly tuned version of the normal 86. I think it had like 215 horsepower. It was highly strong NA. But it was very light because it was all carbon. It had like two seats, like no back seats and stuff, I think.
Yeah.
But I'm actually starting to think that might be a cool angle for my project, rather than taking a BRZ and putting the six-cylinder in. If I just bought myself a white 86, of which there are far more out there compared to BRZs.
I mean, the same car, right?
It's the same car, yeah. And I put the six-cylinder in there, and I give it red Recaros, no back seats, half cage, carbon bonnet, carbon roof, carbon tailgate, little red accents, and basically make a Type R. Well, actually, the engine that I've got, the 3-litre flat six, in the Subaru Legacy, which it came out of, the actual model that got the 3-litre rather than the 2-litre or the 2.5, that was actually called the 3.0R. So I'm actually thinking I'm going to do a GT86 3.0 Type R. And then it's going to have six-cylinder, but it will kind of look Type R. It will be white with red bits all over, and it'll be super light, super leggera.
A bit like an Integra.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's going to be some kind of bastard child of a GT86 and an Integra.
Do you have any thoughts about weight distribution, though? Because if you put... Yeah. I think you told me that six-cylinder isn't actually that much heavier than the four-cylinder.
The six-cylinder is only slightly heavier than the four-cylinder, but some of the things that you have on the four-cylinder... on the six-cylinder, yeah, you don't need... for this swap. So, for example, the weight quoted for the six-cylinder includes power steering pump, but the 86 has got electric power steering, so you can take weight of the power steering pump off. And then there are other things that we're not going to need in there. So things like the battery, the age-old moving the battery to the boot kind of thing, just to keep the 50-50. Luckily, we do have all...
I'm just thinking about traction, obviously, because it's a rear-wheel drive car. If you make the rear of it lighter,
we're going to have to figure that out.
It's great for drifting, might not be great for not going backwards into a barrier or a track.
Well, I mean, luckily, around the corner from me in Henley, there's the old Toyota dealer. It's now in Pent now. Paul's always telling me about it, but he was telling me how they actually have they have a weighing station. So once the car's done, I could take it in there and they can corner weight it and tell me where, you know, how nose heavy or etc. it can be, and I can just start to make adjustments then moving.
Is that the same place that wanted to charge Paul like £3,000 for some front brakes on a Yaris?
Yes, it did. He had a Yaris GRMN before his blue 86, and once the brakes,
apparently the front discs are made of diamond or something.
Unobtainium. it would turn out to be. Anyway, cool. So let's move on from modifying cars then, because we've talked about that a lot. Let's talk about probably the news, because there's been, even now, we're only second month of 2024, and there's already...
Yeah, how did that happen? Well, it happened to January.
There's been some fantastic stuff in the news. I mean, the one that I saw last night, actually, on TopGear.com, you might not have seen this yet, is that there were some leaked pictures of the BMW i16. Yeah, I never heard of it either. But remember the old i8, the coupe?
The sports car thing.
Yes, yeah. So apparently...
I think it looked like a 911 had crashed into the back of it.
Yeah, it had gills like a fish on the back. It wasn't a pleasant thing. But anyway, it looks like BMW were actually scrolling away at making a replacement for that. And they were going to call it the i16. And there were some pictures that were released on to the media. I'll put them in the video at this point. You'll have to just imagine what it looks like. But okay, essentially,
I can look at it on my phone. If I have my phone.
It's okay. I mean, the most important thing is that it was another EV, but it kind of like the old BMW M1. Do you remember where they put the badges in the corners?
Mm.
It looks pretty good, actually. And the most important thing is it's got the old BMW grill, not the stupid great big beaver teeth thing that modern BMWs have. But of course, they didn't go ahead with it.
I think I have seen pictures of this. It kind of was quite sharp-nosed, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it kind of looks like some concept they did ages ago.
Yeah, because they've made a lot of really nice-looking concepts. Yeah. And then all of their actual production cars look like a dog's dinner.
Well, yeah. So I was reading this and I was thinking to myself, right, well, it looks pretty good. And it was going to be an EV that was like the replacement for the i8. So why didn't they go ahead with it? I'm sure that in the Top Gear article, they might explain why they didn't go ahead with it. But
is it because people only buy SUVs, apparently?
Well, I know that it's more the fact that the EVs, EV sports cars, I know we've discussed this in our little Facebook group chat quite a lot, but of course, Porsche cracking on and saying, right, the next Cayman, the next Boxster are going to be EVs. You can lump it or you can take it or leave it.
Well, I think, I still think they mean by that you can buy an EV version of that car.
Well, let's hope so.
I think the GTS will still have a cylinder.
Quite possibly, yeah. It could be the base Cayman.
Yeah, I think the base Cayman will probably be an EV. Or there'll be like a couple of levels of EV performance or something.
Yeah, but like GTS or above, there'll probably be a
bit like how they do with 911s. I think even if they electrify 911s, the GT cars will all still have petrol engines.
Yeah. It's a good point because, of course, Porsche are working with ExxonMobil to make that synthetic fuel.
Yeah.
So why would you be going and doing that if your plan was actually to change all of your product line to use electricity? It makes no sense. They must be drawing a line saying, right, these models will go EV, but these ones will stay petrol.
Well, I think that what they've done is they've looked at the experience that their GT cars and petrol cars at the moment deliver.
Mm.
And how much money they make out of them. Because it's like, you buy a 911 GT3, it's what? 200 grand or something these days?
Probably. Yeah.
If you're allowed to buy one, because you have to have bought 15 other Porsches or something.
Yes, exactly.
And they're really, the experience you have in that car, there's no real way to replicate that in an EV. You can make an EV very fast, and you can make an EV handle well, but you still don't get the same level of involvement and connection with the car, I think.
Yeah.
And I think they have realise that they get that from having a petrol engine with a shifter and a clutch and that sort of stuff, and the experience
and the noise,
all of those things combine to make a driving experience which people will pay 300 grand for or whatever.
Yeah.
And I don't think they know currently how to do that with an EV, because I think EVs have fantastic acceleration, because there's like zero, there's like one moving part and it just goes boom.
Yeah.
Like instant acceleration, but beyond that, I don't know what they do. You have two pedals, it's like driving a go-kart. You have a steering wheel, so you steer, but you're not really involved in the process of getting the car down the road.
The first corner, you've got all that mass.
Yeah,
you know, I've seen some videos of some people taking Taycans on track days, and they're like right past everybody in the straight first corner.
Oh god, yeah,
massive understeer. You know, tyres just wanting to get out and die.
I'd imagine, and unless you spec the carbon ceramic brakes, they probably give up pretty quick.
Oh yeah, pretty much. But also, I mean, this might be different for other countries, but here in the UK, tracks are very much either rejecting EVs for track days, or they're not quite sure how to handle them, because it needs a lot of extra training for the marshals if somebody rolls one and it catches fire, etc. So I think it's Anglesey was the one that was in the news recently, because they decided, right, no more EVs on track days, we're done with it. So
well, I think we went, was it there we went, or some other track day we did, and the marshal was telling us, or telling Paul, I think it was, that they had an incident, or somewhere was an incident where an EV had like had a crash, had gone into a piece of Armco. Somehow the Armco had basically like connected to the battery.
Oh.
And then the first marshal to go and try and help them,
it was getting electric,
touched the barrier and
jeez,
had an injury from it, or possibly even a fatality. I have no idea if that story is true or not.
Well,
but it kind of seems plausible. You can see why you'd be worried about that sort of stuff.
Yeah, totally.
But I think there must be, I think EVs have to go through crash testing, so
yeah,
I think it's possibly a little bit too cautious, shall we say.
Yeah, yeah.
But I just think the thing that worry with me on an EV on a track day is you might get 20 minutes of track time and then 40 minutes of charging and then 20 minutes of track time.
This is it. I mean, the videos I saw of the people there, like Taycans and Model S's going around tracks, they were actually out there for, you know, quite a few laps, like 30, 40 laps
around that. That's a decent number. Yeah.
But even so, when you break for lunch, you're going to very much have to skip your lunch and go driving to somewhere to plug it back in to make sure it's good for the afternoon.
Oh, yeah, I guess not many tracks have got a charging point, right?
No. And if they did have somewhere where they were happy to plug you in, it was probably going to be like a 13-amp, like, 3-pin, like, wall plug or something like that. It's not going to be a fast charger or anything.
Well,
so it's not going to really be
handy. I think even if they had a fast charger, if they follow the same business model that all petrol pumps at tracks I've ever been to, it's like 4 times the cost of normal petrol because they know you're on site and you can't be bothered to go somewhere else.
Yeah, exactly. But no, this is the thing. I mean, I think, you know, for the foreseeable track days will be a internal combustion only kind of event, except for if you go to like the Taurus Fahrten at the Nürburgring, where it's a free for all. You can take whatever you want on the track. So if we go on to the Nürburgring, of course, last year when we went in September, you went out with Mish. Mish drove your car.
Yes.
And I'll pop a little bit of footage up from Mish's video. Not too much, though, because I don't want to get in trouble with him. But
I'd rather you didn't.
How was that? Of course, we all saw the lap. But what was it like entrusting him with your car, but also your life at the same time?
I mean, I didn't ever feel like my life was in danger. Mm. I think I discovered I'm not a good passenger on a lap.
Yes.
And I think it's also one of the very few times I've been in a passenger in that car whilst it's being driven quickly.
Because he didn't seem to be giving it. He was going very fast under bridge into the first.
I mean, he was not sparing any horses as far as I can tell. So it was kind of like, it was kind of fun, but I was like, my car may not survive this because it's a 20-year-old Alfa and I don't know how well everything is working right now. And also our lap was kind of hampered by being half under red yellows because somebody dropped a load of oil somewhere, I think. I don't know if that's what it feels like when I'm doing a lap in my car. It certainly felt like he was going a lot faster than I was.
Yeah.
Like, what was that? Like, when you go down the dip?
Oh, a foxhole.
You said he was hitting, like, 130 or something?
If I remember looking at the speedo.
Yeah, so I don't think I've ever gone over, like, 110 through that bit.
Yeah.
And I do remember, like, the compression at the bottom was like, ugh.
Yeah.
Like, your whole face was being torn off.
Yeah.
So that was interesting. It's like, seeing how much kind of more my car could do if you're a little bit more confident with it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was also, I was talking to him about this at the end of the lap. It was like, it was quite a good way, because he kind of, after he finished the lap, he was like, the engine's great and the brakes are good and blah, 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 blah. And then he was like, but these bits kind of feel a bit soft.
Yeah.
So maybe you could.
He was talking about your gear linkage.
Yeah, he thought the gear linkage was a bit worn out and he was like, the suspension's a bit, like something's a bit worn out there.
Yeah.
So it was like a kind of, it was quite a good sort of health check, if you like, because I then went and looked at when my last replaced the front suspension arms and stuff, and it's like 5 or 6 years ago.
Yeah.
Which on that car is quite a long time because they're made out of like some crappy, cheap
wood.
Well, the bushes themselves are made out of chocolate or something, so they don't last very long. So that, from that perspective, it was quite good. It was like, you know, getting a second opinion on things. Because I've owned that car for 17 years.
Yeah.
It's been tracked for like 12 years. So I'm quite used to how it handles.
Yeah.
So getting another opinion on what's going on, especially somebody driven thousands more cars than I have.
Yeah.
So I would say if you have the opportunity to do it, then you should do it because it's quite interesting to see how somebody else, somebody who's been around a ring a million times would go around a ring.
Mm.
I would just say, if you have any doubts about any mechanical parts in your car, I would just say straight up, maybe fix those before you do it.
Yeah, totally.
Because the only problem I had was the oil temperature was spiking, like a minute into the lap, and I was like, well, if it's on 4 out of 5 bars a minute into the lap, it's probably going to get to 5 bars, and if it gets to 5 bars, the oil at that point is effectively like water.
Yeah, totally.
I still think it went up to 4 bar.
Yeah, probably.
But it wasn't 5 bar.
Yeah.
So I suspect the 20-year-old oil cooler is not cooling oil as much.
A bit blocked or a bit dirty.
Probably a bit falling apart like radiators.
Probably do with increasing, replace with a bigger mochel or something.
Something like that. That definitely is one thing I need to fix this summer.
I think one of the first things I'd like to do is once I've done this flat 686 is actually offer it up to Misha. Because I did actually offer up my orange supercharged 86, but he turned it down. I think he's done a lot of 86 videos, so that's probably why he isn't interested in it. But I'm actually glad after seeing your lap and also Ed's lap as well. Ed actually went out with Misha, but Misha hasn't released that yet. I'm not quite sure whether he's going to release that or whether Ed was just swearing. Ed told me he was swearing a lot in that video.
So I mean, maybe I just was swearing.
Maybe there was too much swearing.
I mean, I haven't actually watched the Misha lap, so I don't know what he put in of me.
Oh, right, okay, swearing. Fair enough. It's quite
like,
good.
No. First couple of corners, so I was like, f***ing hell. Because there was so much extra speed, and it was like, ugh.
Yeah. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is the Grand Tour. They've got a new episode out.
Yes.
I think it's 16th of this week coming.
Sure.
Because I think, what is it, the 11th today? So, Sand Job.
Okay.
I love it where they come up with these names.
Everyone loves a pun.
I think my favourite was their Massive Hunt.
Yes.
Was pretty good. So we've got that to look forward to. But it looks quite good. Unfortunately, this is the final series of the Grand Tour. I think they've got another two episodes after this one. Yeah,
Clarkson's like a million years old.
Oh, yeah.
And I think, what does...
Hammond's obviously running his garage.
And May has a pub.
Yeah, but
he's... And various other things. And he's also... He does lots of other...
Our Man in Japan and Our Man in India and stuff. Yeah. So I mean, it was never going to last forever. Everything's got to end at some point. So it looks like we're going to have to savor these final episodes of Grand Tour. But they are stringing it out. I mean, this season started in 2022, I think, or something. I mean,
just making their specials.
But these specials are part of season 5, which is the final series.
Oh, really?
I wouldn't even be surprised if the last episode even comes this year. It might even be like next year that we get the last episode. But
So there's one more after this one?
There's two more after this, as far as I believe. I mean, I might be wrong. I might have to cut that out because I'm just talking box now.
It's fine, you'll have to do that anyway.
Yes, we are going back to Spa next month.
Yes.
Which is very exciting because we haven't been there since way before lockdown. Was it 2018? 2018. We're very looking forward to that. Are you taking the GTA or the Giulia?
Giulia,
okay, that, cool stuff.
That circuit is a bit like Silverstone, it's a power circuit.
Yeah.
I think a car with less than 300 horsepower around that circuit struggles.
Oh, yes.
Because of that massively long straight,
and the
section into the chicane is very fast as well.
Bus stop,
yeah. And if my GTA would just be like bouncing off limiter the entire lap, I think pretty much. And then you'd have to. It doesn't handle as well as a Giulia, so it would eat its front tires pretty quickly, I think.
Well, I think it was our last Spa trip that that made me decide that I was going to supercharge my 86, because I went round there, and the only time I could get a clean lap without constantly having to indicate right and let people pass me was right at the end of the day when I managed to get a clean lap in, and the only car that overtook me was a Porsche 911, which was quite nice. But I came away from that track day saying, next time I come back here, I'll have over 300 horsepower. So I'm very excited to actually go.
There was a good level of cars. I mean... I found out my Giulia is basically faster than a V8 R8.
Nice.
Considerably, down Australia. Yeah. which was quite cool. And, it was a good day. I got a free ride in a Project 7 as well, I seem to remember.
Oh, yes, that was our friend Dale.
Because they wanted to borrow my car to film it or something, and they were like, we'll give you a free ride in this Project 7.
Yeah, so Dale
Which is insane. It was just like...
Yeah.
It didn't feel like he was going. He was trying that hard, but the level of grip generated by the car was just immense.
Yeah, well, he runs Rent for Ring, which is where me and Paul got that Supra from.
Okay.
On the last NERD trip. Well, of course, on that trip, Greg came along and he brought his blue Mustang.
Yeah.
And there is a new Mustang out now. Have you seen it?
Can I swear on this podcast?
Well, I can always bleep it out.
It looks f***ing awful. Well, certainly the kind of... whatever the fast version is.
Oh, the Dark Horse edition.
Yeah, the one that is like the GT3 version.
It's their hottest one. It's like 500 NA now.
Amazingly bad. Just horrible. It just looks like somebody is taking it to one of those guys in Japan and they've bolted on.
Oh, like a Liberty Walk.
Yeah, Liberty Walk. Yeah, it looks like he's Liberty Walked out of the showroom.
That's a fair thing. That's a fair thing.
I don't know what the normal version looks like, because I thought the previous one to that was quite an attractive car. Like, it looked like a Mustang, but it didn't look like super retro.
Yeah.
I thought it looked really good. This new one I looked at, I was like... the other thing that strikes me is the wheels look really small for some reason.
Yeah, I think...
I don't know why that is.
I mean, I'm a big Mustang fan, and I love the sixth gen, which was what Greg had.
Yeah.
And when I saw the photos of the new seventh gen, which is clearly just a facelift of the old one...
It doesn't seem like a revolutionary...
The front end I quite like. I'm like, oh, you very much softened some of the lines that I didn't like before. Yeah. But then as you move down the back of the car, especially when you get to the back and you've got the tri-bar... they've ruined the back end of it. It looks like one of those dogs that's bending over to have a poo, right? But it's not quite at the point of pooing, it's just clenching.
Maybe it's quite a hard poo and it's struggling
The tail lights on the Gen 7 Mustang kind of look like a Gen 6 is just clenching, ready to drop one. And I'm not a big fan.
I mean, that's what you want in the car design, isn't it?
Well, I like how they've done the under the bonnet changes. Like, when you look at the 5 litre that's in the new one, it's got these twin intakes now. And in the Dark Horse Edition, which is the fastest one they do in America, it's 500 horsepower NA now, which is amazing. That's great tuning. But I want that engine in the previous shaped car, I think.
Mm. Well, you could kind of get that, couldn't you? In the...
You get the Shell
GT350.
Yeah.
That was a naturally aspirated engine, was it not?
Yeah, that was that flat plane crank.
But it was like 600 horsepower, I think.
I don't even think it was. No. I think it was a lot less than that. I think it was like 525 or something. But the GT500 is like 700 horsepower.
Yeah, because that's his supercharged, isn't it?
Yeah.
And those cars I thought were very nice. I thought they were a little bit overblown.
Yeah.
Perhaps, but it's an American thing, so you know.
Bit weighty.
That's kind of what you get.
Yeah.
Bit weighty, but not horrendously slow horrendously heavy for a muscle car.
Yeah.
I think they're still over 2 ton, aren't they? Or maybe just on the edge.
Yeah.
So it's not like. There's lots of other cars comparable. It's like.
Yeah.
You know, muscle cars have never been light.
Yeah.
And that's never been their thing, right?
Exactly.
But yeah, I can't get on with a new one.
No.
I would buy, like, there's one round here, actually. There's like a, I think it's the previous one.
Yeah.
A yellow, like, normal one.
Yeah.
That I see quite often.
Which is a great colourful.
Yeah, I see quite often in the supermarket. It looks fantastic. Mm. And it sounds great as well, because you can hear it. Like, he's obviously got a better exhaust on it, because you can hear it from, like, some miles away.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was like, why would you mess with that too much?
Exactly. Well, I mean, there's a great tuning market out there for them. You can buy yourself a 5 litre and you can do a huge amount of NA tuning mods. People are getting 500 NASP horsepower out of the previous shape.
Well, there's a lot more options to you now for naturally aspirated, where you can get different cams, you can remap quite a lot because of all the variable valve timing and all the kind of, you know, electronic injection and stuff like that. But previously, if I was to try and tune my GTA, for example, I could spend a very large amount of money and get maybe 50 extra horsepower. And I just don't, there's no point. It's got plenty of power as it is.
Yeah, exactly. Like, exactly.
300 horsepower would not improve this car. It would just make it slightly harder to drive, probably.
Yeah, totally.
Because I think at the moment, the GTA's got a good level of power versus grip.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I wouldn't do that. But I think now, if you've got like a modern-ish naturally aspirated engine, you can go quite far with that if you want to.
Yeah, totally.
I mean,
yeah.
I never really truly understand why people chase so much horsepower. It's like, if you've got a 500 horsepower car...
It's a number.
Having a 600 horsepower car doesn't make it better.
No, exactly. Torque is more important than...
Yeah, I would never tune my Giulia, because like, it has way too much power to use as it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Certainly for my... driving level.
Yeah.
So just making it more powerful would just make it scarier, frankly.
Yeah, totally.
Okay. Yeah, so would you buy one of the new... Would you say, hypothetically, you had enough money to buy a new Mustang, would you get one, or would you get a second-hand one of the previous version?
I'd probably get a second-hand the previous version. Yeah. Even though I can appreciate what they've done with the interior, they've given it big touchscreens and stuff.
Ugh.
But I think it just makes the interior look awful.
Yes.
And I really like the front
of the interior of that Mustang wasn't fantastic to start with.
It's basically the same interior as the previous shape. The only thing they've done is they changed the dashboard, giving it some touch screens. Inside, it's exactly the same car. I would get one with the Recaro seats, though. Because especially when we were going out with Greg and his Mustang at Spa, I found those standard seats weren't that good at holding you in. There was a lot of sliding about. So I'd get a Recaro interior. But yeah, I'd probably get the previous shape. I think it's a better looking car, and I can just do without the touch screens. And then, yeah, the extra horsepower the new car gets, you just throw the money you've saved at tuning up the older generation car. So, but I think we're almost done. The last thing I wanted to discuss is the new GI Yaris before we wrap up, because...
Well, the one that Dr. Paul's got.
No, GI Yaris.
Oh, Yaris,
the new one. Yeah, so they've just facelifted it.
Yeah.
So they've given it a slightly bigger intake on the front bumper to help with cooling.
Yes.
They've changed the interior of it, and now it has a big, almost like a flat dashboard, like off of a lorry.
Is that to get around the fact that there's the previous one had a mirror that was so massive you couldn't see out the front of the car?
Yeah, the mirror was too far down. It was blocking your visibility. The seats were too high up. Yeah. So they've dropped the seats. They've moved the mirror right up as far as it could possibly go. And they've given you a new dashboard, which gives you slightly better visibility. But also they've moved buttons into more convenient places, so you don't have to reach so far to get them now.
Okay.
But the big things are, under the bonnet, more horsepower now.
Yes.
The circuit pack, which was an optional extra, is just now mandatory, because nobody was really in their right mind specking one without the circuit pack. Who would not want front and rear diffs?
Well, quite. It's not, diffs. I don't understand why you would pick that.
and then the controversial thing is that new 8-speed auto. And I know you're a big fan of manuals.
But importantly, that's an option.
It isn't mandatory.
It's not like the only
you
thing
can you can still get the new Yaris GR with a manual option. But the auto... I mean, I always said when the Yaris GR came out that I thought it was a fantastic car. The only thing is I didn't want to go into manual because I love my paddle shift auto. But now the 8-speed Yaris GR is out, I'm having to put my money where my mouth is, and I've actually joined the waiting list.
Oh, really?
To see if I could buy one. I mean, I don't know how much they're going to be, but I very much want to drive one and see what they're like.
Well, to be honest, having a manual in that car isn't as important to me as... in a small sports car or something like that, because that car is literally a rally car, right?
It's rapid.
So if you want to replicate the rally car for the road experience, then having a flappy paddle gearbox,
because they're all sequential WRC cars anyway, aren't
they? they've been you know, paddle shift or sequential for 25 years or something. So that kind of lines up with what the car is.
Yeah.
I still think a manual one would probably still be more fun. Do they still have a manual handbrake?
Yes, they do.
Because I think that's an important thing. If you buy a rally car, you want to be able to do handbrake turns. Can you do handbrake turns in the automatic one is the question.
I guess so.
You would think they would
try. I can't remember what the interior of the car looks like.
Yeah, whether it has... Because that would be a thing. If you tick the box for the automatic... and it deletes the manual handbrake and gives an automatic, an electric one, that's a different kettle of fish, right?
Yeah.
Because then you can't do cool handbrake turns all the time.
Yes.
So that bit would worry me more.
Yeah.
The gearbox itself, it would still be a very fun car. You could I've seen people go around corners like four-wheel drifting.
Mm.
It looks like a very capable car.
Yeah.
It would destroy most things on the track day, I'm pretty certain, with the right tyres on it.
Yeah. The new Yaris...
It would embarrass a lot more expensive cars.
Yeah, imagine the new Yaris on R888 with that flappy paddle gearbox and the extra horsepower, because it's basically 300 horsepower now. That thing would be absolutely rapid. It would be you versus all the aerial atoms and the Caterhams, I think. It would be absolutely mental.
I think that car would be 911 speed.
Yeah.
For a fraction of the cost.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if it had the right set of tyres and the right driver, it'd probably be faster.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm not saying I'm definitely going to get one, but I'm definitely putting my name down so that I've got the opportunity.
Is there any Has anybody tested the 8-speed yet?
Yes. So there have been some YouTubers that have gone and done quarter miles of the old manual, the new manual, and the auto next to each other.
Was there a new? Have they changed the ratio in the manual box or something?
I think the ratios have changed.
Okay. I mean, a drag race is a kind of pointless test because automatic will always be faster than the manual in a straight line.
And it has launch control as well.
So that's like, yes, something that is better, you have proved it is better.
Yes.
That's not the argument about having a manual gearbox.
Oh, no. I totally understand why you would want a manual gearbox, because there is a level of involvement that you have there that you don't get with an auto.
Yeah.
But I think, especially browsing the forums, I think there's a lot of people who see auto and they say, oh, it's boring. And it's because they don't realise that, you know, a modern auto with flappy paddles, once you put it in manual mode, it will not auto upshift. You will just bounce off the rev limiter all day. Basically, putting a flappy paddle auto into manual mode and using the shifters makes it a manual. The only thing you're missing is that clutch engagement.
Your left leg is not doing anything.
And your left hand is not using a shifter, it's using a paddle instead. Mm. So you still have that level of engagement, obviously not to the point of a manual where you've got to do the clutch work, but you still have that level of engagement in an automatic that is akin to a manual.
I think modern ones are much better.
Yeah.
Because the whole argument used to be that it wouldn't change when you wanted it to change. Yeah. It would do things you didn't want it to do.
Yeah.
And my experience of a modern auto is it pretty much instantly responds unless you ask it to do something stupid. So,
exactly. Well, you drove mine on Pembury.
Yes.
It was a very drifty track.
It was a very drifty track. I mean, I thought the gearbox was all right, but I just thought the ratios were way too long.
Because
I was in third gear for the whole lap.
The ratios are long. I mean, that is not great for a standard 86. However, if you go turbo to supercharger, you've then got this extra power and torque. So those gear ratios being long,
they're kind of shortened if you add power,
well,
I guess.
You put power, it fills those ratios better because you're powering through those ratios. The red line comes up a lot quicker.
You use the gear quicker.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
But like, do you only say the manual versus auto thing, I think, is just what do you want from a car? People get the same experience driving an auto as somebody who loves manuals will drive a manual.
Yeah.
I just think if you're making a sports car, and a sports car is a car that has no real practical purpose.
No, it's just...
The purpose of a sports car is to be enjoyable to drive, right? That's its whole purpose of existing, is like, when you drive it, it is fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, people get fun in different ways.
Yeah.
But I think fundamentally, if you're taking... If there's a part of driving and you're kind of letting the car do it itself...
Gotcha.
It's like... It's taking something away from the drive, from that driving experience is the whole thing I have about manuals. It's like my GTA is a manual. It's not like it's an amazing manual gearbox. It's nice enough, but like that car wouldn't be nearly as enjoyable to drive if it had the crappy silly speed version of that gearbox. And I think the flip side, I think we discussed this as well, like if I put a manual gearbox or I got a manual gearbox in my Giulia, which they did do briefly, I don't think it would be as enjoyable to drive.
It's a lot of power
there's a lot more going on.
Yourself, yeah.
There's a lot more going on. And if you're in a bad situation and you're having to like change gear like that rather than with a paddle with your hand on the wheel, I think you probably would have crashed it by now.
Yeah.
Some people did drive the manuals when they were first out and said that they were okay, but like they could clearly tell that the car had been designed with that ZF8 speed in mind.
Which is why the Supra came out with only an auto option, because that makes sense for the power and the performance of that car.
And also that engine had already been built to work with that gearbox.
And they eventually gave in and gave you a manual option, but nobody bought it, because the first thing you notice when you're driving the manual is like, Jesus, this is a lot of power to have to stir through the gears myself, and it makes an already quite dangerous car in the wrong hands deadly.
Well, because they're 500 horsepower, basically. I think Again, manuals have a lot of caveats. It's like people, like you say, there are people in the world who are like manual good, automatic bad. Yeah. And I don't think it's that simple. It's like manual on a small car with, say, less than 300 horsepower, great.
Yeah.
A manual on a massive car with 600 horsepower,
not
so good.
This thing, my BRZ, sorry, my six-cylinder 86, that's going to be a manual.
Yeah.
I was tempted to get another flappy paddle car for this project, but the only problem is as I'm keeping the orange one, I need to have them different enough to justify keeping them both.
I think a six-cylinder and a manual gearbox is a good combination.
Yeah. And I've also got both then.
How much horsepower is it? Like,
it's going to be about the same as the orange one. It's going to be about three. Well, this is the thing. Originally, the plan for my flat six was going to be individual throttle bodies and try to get up to 300 horsepower. But now I've decided to go supercharger because there's a company in Australia that do a supercharger for it.
I wouldn't even do that, Lee. I would just give it a better induction system or something like that, and just keep it naturally aspirated.
Yeah.
And just make it, if you can, make it increase the revs and just make it a bit of a screamer.
260 horsepower should be really easy to get out of it.
Like a vocal six-cylinder making 260 horsepower manual gearbox is a very good combination in my mind. And would be quite enjoyable to drive. It wouldn't be the fastest thing in the world.
No.
But then, you know, we're not setting lap times here, are we? No. So it's like, it's all about what you want from the car.
Exactly. But no, I mean, yes, exactly what you said. I mean, when you get a sports car, most important thing is that it's fun. And like, using the 86 as an example, yes, you can buy it as a manual or an auto. Both are very fun out on track, in slightly different ways. But the most important thing is, a lot of people think that you get an auto, you drive it on track in auto mode all the time, which is, you just don't. You don't.
I wouldn't even know. It wouldn't. You'd be changing gear mid-corner when you didn't expect it. Yeah. It'd be horrible.
Yeah, exactly. If you're gonna buy a auto, you're gonna take it on track. You put it in manual mode, and then you just use it like a normal manual car.
The only thing about the GT86 is the auto is considerably slower to 60 than the manual, right?
That's because of the gearing. Yeah. So, figures wise, the 86 auto is, well, it's like 8 seconds or 60 or something like that, which a lot of people just see those figures and they're like, nope, it's too slow because it's got a slow 0-60.
The car's not really about power.
What they don't realise, though, is that out on track, that doesn't matter because you're never coming to a stop, so 0-60 is just pointless, and you're never getting to the top speed of 140 miles an hour or whatever it is. So it's the mid-range performance that is important. And yes, it has longer gears than the manuals, but as long as you keep the rev up, as long as you keep the revs as high as possible, and you're saving so much time through the flappy paddles. Like, back when my car was totally stock, I was going around all the manual 86 owners as though they were, you know, they weren't fully depressing the throttle. And I had some people come up to me and said, you know, why is your car so fast? I'm like, it must just be the auto, because I'm not a great driver. It just must be the fact that every time they get a shift, they come off the power, I'm not having to back off and I'm just gaining on them. And actually, in a couple of videos, I was noticing, I was coming past them and they were, it like, lumps.
Yeah, things like downshifting in a manual is a bit of an art. And it's not something you can easily learn. So, especially in a rear-wheel drive car, if you do a shonky downshift, you're basically locking the rear wheels at that point.
Which I've done in the Monaro Anglesey, yeah.
So, like, downshifting in your automatic one, it's doing that bit for you.
Yes.
So, I'm not surprised you're going past people on the track.
Oh, yeah.
Because they are doing, like, you know, clutch, shift.
Exactly.
And you're going shift, basically.
And the gearbox prevents you from locking up the wheels and downshifting too early. I mean, a lot of people in reviews and on YouTube have said that they're annoyed by the fact that it won't downshift when you want it to shift.
No, that's a good thing.
But that's a safety measure. Yeah.
I had that on my Giulia at Thruxton, where I pushed the down paddle instead of the up paddle. Yeah. And it ignored me, which was good, because if it hadn't ignored me, it probably would have blown up the engine.
from a buyer's perspective, if you go and buy an auto car, you know that engine never been over revved.
Yeah.
Like, you never heard spoons on spoons, because the ECU will just not let you knacker the engine or the gearbox, which is a great thing. But also, it just means that I can hoon it around a track and I can shift when I want to. If it won't let me do it, I just try again. I just keep trying it. It will let me put it into gear. But it just means that I can just abuse the car on the track. And
that's what you want. You want to go to a track day and get some performance out of the car, right?
Exactly.
If your car, I mean, I always say this to people about track days, is like, if your car is not, you know, they're like, oh, you take your car to track day, it'll trash it. It's like, it's not going to trash it.
Nah.
It's going to trash very specific parts of it.
Exactly.
It's going to trash the brakes. It's probably going to trash the tyres.
Exactly.
Everything else will be totally fine.
Exactly.
If you can't do that when you're driving, it's very frustrating.
Yeah.
If you're having to, like, slow down because your tyres are giving up or your brakes are giving up or whatever, you know, you want to improve those things so you can just go and do 10 laps and not worry about it.
Yeah, totally.
I just want to go back to electric sports cars.
Oh, yes, yeah. Because we've had a couple out like the Lotus and Maya, stupid name, has been.
Is that a sport? So well, this is my thing. I don't think there is
saloon.
I don't think there is currently an electric sports car.
Well, you've got
in the way that I would perceive a sports car.
Well, you've got the Tesla Roadster, which is ancient and nobody can buy it. And it was a Lotus with a heavy Lotus Elise.
With a load of batteries in the middle.
Yeah. Who does anybody make an electric sports car?
There's an MG one.
The Cyberster.
That is on its way. But looks quite cool.
50-60 grand.
Yeah.
Really, what we're waiting for is the new electric Cayman Boxster, and also Toyota have got the new MR2 replacement. It's not an MR2, it's the FTS.
Well, it's only an MR2 if it will kill you.
Well, exactly. There are some electric sports cars coming.
This is the thing, I want to see how they're going to, or what they're going to do to give you that driving experience, because I think the only choice they've had so far for a sports car that's electric is they're like, look how fast it goes. It does not 60 in 1.8 seconds. It's got 700 horsepower. And you're like,
it's all about figures, isn't it?
That's cool. What's it like to drive? It's like, oh, it's a bit like woolly, yeah, and it's very heavy, yeah, and the steering's not very nice. And you're like, okay, well. So once you get over the fact that you can break people's necks with the acceleration.
Exactly.
It's not really fulfilling a sports car kind of niche.
I agree with that. I can't think of a single actual EV sports car out there. The closest we've got is we've got super saloons like the Taycan.
I think the Taycan is probably the closest. And even then, I'd be like, if I was buying, because that is like a sports saloon, a bit like my Julia, really. Yeah. If I was buying that, I'd buy the base spec one that has like 450 horsepower. It's rear wheel drive.
Yeah.
Like, that's much more attractive to me than the one that's 700 horsepower and four wheel drive. And I'm like, it's just way too much.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, if you look at the top spec Model S, the Plaid, or Plaid, or whatever they call it, that's over 1,000 horsepower. They've just facelifted the Taycan. That's nearly 1,000 horsepower. The Lotus Maya, whatever it's called, that is like over 900 horsepower. So, it's gone a bit mad.
It is gone a bit mad, because the whole point of EVs, right, is to be non-polluting and be efficient.
Yeah.
So how have we got into a situation where all the new EVs coming out are like 1,000 horsepower, weigh 3 tons, cost you 200 grand?
Something's
gone wrong there. Surely.
I can only hope that it's the whole economies of scale kind of thing. You remember when Tesla first came out with their Model S after the Roadster? The Model S came out and it was quite expensive. It was a big model, but the idea was
remind me which one the Model S.
S is the one that keeps setting the Nürburgring records. It's like it's similar size to your car, your Jupiter.
Oh yeah.
And then of course they then made the Model 3,
yes,
which was considerably cheaper. But they had to do it in that order because they almost used the Model S as the test bed to figure stuff out and then make it cheaper. So I'm hoping that in the same way that they did that, maybe the fact that we've got the Taycan and then the Lotus, and we've got things like the Lucid Air, which is like a crazy electric hyper four-door. You've got these powerful saloon cars that have got 1,000 horsepower, these EVs, and I'm just hoping that they've gone to there first because that's where they kind of get the technology nailed down and then they can make more affordable models below.
Yeah.
The same reason that Lotus has got that 2,000 horsepower Evija.
The hypercar.
2,000 horsepower. The reason they've done that first is they can take all the lessons they've learned
from
it.
They can turn down the wick.
Yeah, improve the technology, and then they can make an electric. I mean, they have got an electric mirror replacement coming, which I hope it's going to be called the Esprit, just for nostalgia purposes. But it's going to be like
it's going to make a lot of people in flat caps angry, though.
When the Amira,
can't call it that. It's not got engines. I do like the look. I don't know the specs of it, but I really like the look of the Lotus saloon car they're making.
That the Yamaha.
That looks far more attractive to me than the big SUV thing.
Yeah, they made the Electra.
Whatever. These names are just stupid.
This is basically a saloon version of it. They were some nice pictures of it. I think I shared them in our group chat the other day. But I mean, that is, I would have that over the Taycan and the Model S Plaid and also the Audi e-tron GT. And yes, a lot of people say that, oh, it's just all Chinese stuff with the Lotus badge on it, except that there was not that car did not exist in China under like a Zhongxi.
No, it's not been rebadged.
It is a Lotus.
It's been developed to do that car.
Yeah, it's built in China because the the Hethel factory over here is kind of dedicated to building the sports cars. So anything that isn't a sports car.
Well, also, let's just be realistic. It's cheaper to build things in China.
Well, yeah, as well, yeah.
They probably have all the natural resources locally to them or within country, and they have cheap labour.
Yeah, exactly.
And we don't have those things. Exactly. So it's just going to be, you know, just from a financial perspective, it just makes, if you want to build cars and not go bust, you have to do them so you make money.
Yeah.
And you make that by making the chip production as cheap as you can whilst still keeping it.
Exactly.
You know, good.
And at the end of the day, I mean, I know a lot of people say that, well, Lotus has sold itself to the devil. It was always simplify, then add lightness, and now it's overcomplifying and add weight. But
yeah, but that was like for 5 minutes in the 60s when Colin Chapman owned it. It's like, it's been through a lot of owners since then. And the fact that it still exists should be applauded.
Exactly.
It's a bit like Aston Martin. Aston Martin really shouldn't exist anymore because it went to two or three very rocky patches.
Yeah, totally.
And now we've ended up where I think it's doing all right.
Yeah.
It's found its audience, which seems to be rich people in the Middle East, probably.
Yeah, yeah.
And it seems to be selling enough cars to keep going. Yeah, I mean,
Lotus was selling, 600 cars a year at one point? Now they've got orders for 15,000 cars or something like that.
Yeah, the Emira has like a two-year waiting list or something, isn't it?
Yeah, it's crazy. And then when you think you've also got the Electra SUV and you've got the Emeya EV saloon now. So, they're, you know, at the end of the day, you've got to make a company profitable. Otherwise, you know, it's not going to last very long. And there are people I read on the Piston Heads forum the other day. It's quite funny. Somebody was saying, and rightly so, that, you know, they brought out the original Mark 1 Elise, the S1. And people were complaining how it leaked and it had no electric windows and it had no power steering. So in the S2, they added electric windows, power steering, a better roof. And then people were complaining how much heavier it was in the original. It's like, well, you can't win. You genuinely can't win. So we got to stop.
People are never satisfied.
Yeah. At the end of the day, the Emira has a massive jump up in quality compared to the previous Lotus cars. I mean, I should know. I had a Spring. It was absolutely bag of shonky bits, but the Emira is now a massive step forward. Yes, it's a lot heavier than previous Lotuses, but I would definitely have it over old Lotuses, even though they're heavy. It's heavier because it's just a proper car. Those always old Lotuses always just felt like kit cars. There was a smell of canoe glue and stuff. I mean, they're proper production cars now. So
I just think, so I think sports car wise, I think the way they'll do it, although I think, well, this is what I would do, is I wouldn't try to make an electric sports car in the way that we see sports cars now. I would literally reserve petrol engines for sports cars because, realistically, sports cars make up a tiny fraction of what is sold globally.
Yeah.
If everything else is electric, selling a few thousand petrol cars every year makes no difference, effectively. So I think, hopefully, manufacturers will calm down a little bit on the whole power statistics and just start making EVs that are actually like efficient. And so, you know, if somebody released an EV tomorrow that did 1,000 miles on a charge and the charging network was easy to use, it would sell like crazy, assuming it wasn't £200,000. I think we're just on the cusp of, like, we're in this weird transition period where EVs are available but they're not quite as convenient as a petrol car. In some instances, they are. Like, if you're a homeowner and you've got a charging point, they work great. If you're forced to use the charging network, it's very hit or miss whether you'll find one that works and charges properly and all that sort of stuff. So I think the focus has to really be on getting, you know, quote unquote normal people to just have an EV. Because like, if the figures are like you're selling 6 million EVs a year and you're selling 10,000 petrol cars, that level of pollution is negligible, basically. You know, the amount of reduction there is it more than enough to hit the target we want.
Yeah, and I think also people are, I think that the EV hype has kind of ended now, because like this year, Toyota have sold more hybrids than a lot of other companies have sold EVs.
Yes.
Like the hybrid sales are outstripping the EV sales.
Because, again, you're getting, it's efficiency, right? And a hybrid petrol car is more efficient than a petrol car.
Yeah.
And it's easier to live with than an EV.
Yeah.
Because you just go to the petrol station, you fill it up just like a normal petrol car.
Yeah.
And then it just adds efficiency. So, like, I am not surprised that people are like, well, why would I, like, have, you know, the possible inconvenience of dealing with an EV when I could just buy a more efficient car that works like it's always worked.
Or a plug-in hybrid, then you've got the best of both worlds. If you do want to drive your short distance to the office and back in fully electric mode, there you
go. Here's a question about plug-in hybrids. Do they charge themselves? Or do they have the ability to charge themselves? Because I was speaking to somebody, and they said that most plug-in ones don't have that facility. It's like you either have one, you either have a hybrid or you have a plug-in hybrid.
Well, I can't speak for other manufacturers, but Toyota, for example, they do hybrid models. Like, let's take the Prius, for example. The last generation Prius, you could get just a normal hybrid or you get the plug-in hybrid.
Yeah.
They worked in exactly the same way. The only difference was the plug-in hybrid had a slightly bigger battery and it had a plug.
Yeah.
And the, you know, when you
So it could run an EV mode longer.
Yeah, if you buy a plug-in hybrid, you never need to plug it in. You can just drive it like a normal hybrid, and of course when the battery gets low, petrol engine comes on, recharge itself as you drive. But the benefit obviously is that you can plug it in, and then if you do want to do a short journey to work and back in the morning without using any petrol, that slightly bigger battery and the ability to plug it in will allow you to do that. But then if you go from your office on a long drive up to Scotland, you just put petrol in it and you just treat it like a normal car. And I think that is what makes them so popular.
Yeah. It's like the good bits of both systems, right?
Yeah. So maybe that would be the way, rather than making pure EV cars, maybe just take plug-in hybrids and just increase the capacity of the battery over and over so that people just stop putting petrol in them.
That will happen because batteries will get better and better and better. So, like, in the same physical space, you'll have more energy.
Yeah.
So, a hybrid now, I don't know, it probably has, like, 50 miles range, maybe, or 20 miles range or something like that.
Well, mine...
as pure EV?
If you drove it on a flat surface, no hills or anything like that, and it had a fully charged battery, I could probably drive for about 5 miles.
Okay,
and then
so 5 miles.
Yeah.
But if you take that, if you, you know, we wind the clock forward 10 years.
Battery technology improves,
You know, you put in the same space that you currently have your battery that does 5 miles, you might have a battery that does 100 miles or something like that.
Exactly.
And then it becomes like very easy to do mostly electric travel.
Yeah, petrol engine would hardly ever come on.
Yeah. I mean, I think I was watching some other thing. I think it was Throttle House where they were like, I think they were testing a Tenale or something like that, and it was the hybrid version. And the guy was saying, it was either that or the Dodge Dart or Avenger, whatever the Dodge version of the same car is.
Yeah.
He was saying that he knew somebody who drove to work and basically the engine never switched on.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he'd plug it in at work and it would charge, and he'd drive home and again the engine would never switch on.
Yeah.
And he was advised by the garage, it's like, you can do that, but you need to allow the engine to start like once every 2 weeks or something, just to keep everything.
You just put the heater on.
Or something like that, just because the engine can't just sit there not running because it'll ruin it.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, then you know, you're not polluting virtually.
Exactly.
Or not polluting as much, because you're still getting electricity probably from a coal power station or something.
Yeah.
And that seems like a much better way of doing it without making you.
And then on a long journey.
Like, completely change all the infrastructure, spend hundreds of thousands of pounds on a car. It's like, that's got to be better for normal people.
Exactly.
Right?
And then when you're going somewhere that isn't your office, if you're driving up to see friends and family in Wales or something like that, you just use petrol to get there. You don't have to stop like on a Tesla and figure out all the places you're going to stop and recharge it along the way or something like that. This is definitely the way forward. So I think that's a good place to end the video. So thank you very much for your time today. I appreciate spending some time chit-chatting with me about, we love talking about cars, don't we?
So. This is what we're talking about anyway. Like, it's literally just a normal conversation.
We've just got some microphones and some cameras, and that's any difference.
Yeah.
But we're going to go off to the pub now. I've promised Ross a lobster dinner. So
I wouldn't order a lobster dinner from this pub.
Anyway, thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. And let us know in the comments if you enjoyed our podcast and our chit-chat today. And also if you've got any suggested names. No rude ones, though, please. We might do this again in the future if it's popular with you guys. So, thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.